This is what we do in science. Observe, question, then hypothesize, predict, and experiment. All that procedure that you do, whatever you call a scientific method, it basically deals with how type of questions. It basically deals with how things are happening. It only describes, for example, how the planets are moving, it describes. It only describes the interaction, the patterns, how the patterns of nature are. But no matter how much you describe the how question, all the laws and principles, they address only the how question. How this is like that, how that is like that. So a pattern is given, this is how the pattern is. But no matter how much you explore the how part, this is again a quote from one of the scientists, actually this is Richard Feynman. The principles must be about something, and what is that something? What is that something? When you ask that question, what? It's a different type of question now. It's not a how question. Okay, you read that. Take 10 seconds. So all your laws, law of gravitation or theory of relativity or whatever, quantum physics, they all deal with how things are happening, how things are interacting, how they are moving about, all these things. But naturally you have to get this question, what is it that is behaving like in a particular way? This is another statement from another scientist, Roger Penrose, he's from UK. So we are knowing mainly in science how the contents of the universe behave, what question is addressed in a particular way, I'll come to it. But all these laws and principles mainly deal with how things are happening. What is that thing is a different question. Did you get this point?
Yes.
Yes.
See, when you come to what part of science, it is not as simple as how. Describing how is easier. You just describe a pattern. This is how things are happening. How things are happening. What is that thing is a different question. When you come to that question, basically what happens in science is there is a certain approach. One is called reducibility. Reducibility means when you ask, for example, what is a stone? You answer, what is it made up of? You reduce it to something and something else. If you ask, what is A? You will tell A is made up of B. You pass on to B. So you say it is made up of something. It is made up of molecules. What are molecules? You say it is made up of atoms. What are atoms? It is made up of energy packets. Something like this. So one way of addressing what question is just passing on A to B, B to C. It's not actually addressing, it is just passing on. Another way of addressing the what question is relativity. So you describe, if you ask what is A, you say it is not B. Relativity. Relativity is another way of addressing the what questions. You cannot absolutely answer what is this, so you tell that is not that. So if you ask what is A, you will answer it is not B, it is not C, it is not D. You will answer what it is not. You will do nethi-nethi. In science also they do nethi-nethi. And relativity is in fact well ingrained in your day-to-day experience. Even your normal experience is all relative. What you experience as colors is relative. You may not be aware of it, but that is how your neurons function. That is how your nervous system functions. When you look at brown, for example, you may think that I'm experiencing brown as it is, absolutely. But actually how your brain works is, it processes this particular information of whatever it is getting, light wavelength. It processes that comparing to what all it is not. It will compare with it is not red, it is not black, it is not yellow, it is not sound, it is not touch. It experiences this as what it is not. You may not be aware of it, but that's how it is. The brain itself functions relatively. You don't experience anything absolutely. When you see light, you are experiencing light because of darkness, experience of darkness. Because there is memory of darkness, you experience light. Because there is experience of light, you experience darkness. It is relative, mutual. You never experience light absolutely. There is always a memory of the opposite one or something contrasting one backing it. That is what is giving you the experience. Did you follow this? So what happens in science when we address the what questions are these two ways. One way of addressing is reducibility, another way of addressing it is relativity. This is how they address the what questions. Now, this is a well-known thing. This is a limitation of language also. This is another quote. Okay, I told you who they were. This is Heisenberg, one of the quantum physicists. It's not only him that has told this, many people have told this. It's a common, in the morning also I was mentioning it with one example. When we ask what is yoga, we say yoga is Atma Paramatma joining. You define one word with respect to another word only. That is a limitation. To replace one word, you have to bring in another word. So if there is one particular word that is unknown to you, how will you define that unknown word? One of the things is what Narada did. You use something known and say extend it and you say this is that. That is one way of doing it. But whatever definitions you come up with, they will have to define one concept with the help of some other concept. That is how definitions are given. So ultimately, you will have to have some concepts which are not defined. There has to be an end to that chain. If you define A with respect to A in terms of B, if you define B in terms of C, if you C in terms of D, it's an infinite regression. You will go on defining, your definitions will not never end. At some point you have to stop and say these are fundamental entities and you cannot define them. So one of the examples I've given, there is energy. Energy is not, you cannot define it. It is just there. You can describe it in various ways, its laws and whatever. What is energy? You cannot define it. It is one of the fundamental entities. You can say it is conserved at this and that. No matter what you describe, you are not defining it. Space-time is another. Electric charge is another example. It is one of the fundamental entities of the creation, that's it. You cannot define charge again with something else. So some entities have to be taken, as he says, they have to be taken as they are, unanalyzed, undefined. You have to just take them. It is there, we experience it, it is there, but we can't define it, we can't define what it is. So when you do with the what part, this is a limitation. You can define one with respect to another only. This is what I was referring to as relativity. This is another statement from another. I'm quoting all prominent people because if I simply say, you may not believe me. Therefore, I'm putting the photo also. That Ajja is Bertrand Russell. He is one of the philosophers. And the person next to him is Arthur Eddington. That Eddington I referred yesterday. Chandrasekhar's incident I was telling. That is Eddington. Because of who the Chandrasekhar limit was delayed, not published, whatever. So this statement comes from them. Both of them, I think it was a compiled statement. Both of them must have told something similar. So they said, physics is great at telling us what matter does. It doesn't tell us what matter is. So one simple thing I can tell you with respect to that definition thing is, you go to dictionary and you see what is matter. Matter, for matter what they have given. They will give something like matter is an entity that has mass. You go to the word mass, and it will write, mass is that constitutes matter. That's a limitation, that's how it is. eventually you have to make it circular. Instead of making infinite regression, you have to make it circular and you have to define one with respect to each other, and then you put an end to that definition business. Mass is defined with respect to matter, matter defined with respect to mass. Over, okay. Meaning we cannot do anything else. Similarly, I still remember from the early primary school, somehow I remember this, I don't know how. In my fifth standard, when these fundamental concepts were being described, energy, force, work, all these things, they defined, I don't know if it is a formal definition, maybe only for primary school they defined like that, maybe. But still, that applies there also. So energy was defined as, energy is that which performs work. And what is work? Work is that is performed by energy. It is circular, you have to make it circular somewhere. Now this business has come into every, it happens everywhere actually, without your knowledge it happens. It has happened with consciousness, awareness also. Consciousness is equal to awareness, awareness is equal to consciousness. Circular definitions, you replace one with another. So this is called, this is a name for that. Whatever I am describing, it is called